Hello and let's talk about the alleged custodial killing of two men in Tamil Nadu. The men, P. Jayaraj, who was 60, and his son, J. Benix, who was 31, died at a hospital on June 22nd and 23rd respectively after having been detained on June 19th. The cases led to an uproar in Tamil Nadu and across the country over the way the police functions. This is an especially significant issue at a time of the lockdown when they have been granted considerable amounts of power. We'll discuss this issue, but first here are some details of the case. Jayaraj and Benix were detained from their mobile shop for allegedly violating lockdown restrictions. They were remanded to judicial custody and lodged at the Kovilpatti sub-jail on June 20th. Frontline quotes relatives of the men as saying that they had been brutally beaten up and even tortured even before being brought to the magistrate. A report from the Hindu also cites that their injuries were suffered before they were brought to the sub-jail. In the coming days, they fell ill and were admitted to the Kovilpatti government hospital, where they died. Human rights activists say that the men were not directly even presented before the magistrate, who remanded them nonetheless. The incident has led to major protests in Tamil Nadu as well as calls for an inquiry. Due to the pressure, Chief Minister Edappadi Palaniswamy was forced to announce the CBI inquiry into the case on Sunday. The Madurai bench of the Madras High Court is looking into the issue. An inspector and two sub-inspectors have been placed under suspension, and opposition parties are demanding that murder charges be filed against those police officers responsible. We talked to a Tamil Nadu correspondent, Neelambaran, on this issue. Thank you, Neelambaran, for joining us. So, we've just looked at some of the key details of the case. So, could you tell us a bit about what exactly is the ground, a situation on the ground right now, especially in Thoothukudi district, but also in the rest of Tamil Nadu, because last week there's been an upsurge of protests on this issue. So, what's exactly happening? What is the government stand? And what are some of the key issues political parties, opposition parties and social movements are raising?
As you know, the case has come out, you know, as another example of the police brutality in Tamil Nadu. It's like there are a lot of previous examples as well. And this has come at a time when, you know, the lockdown is ongoing. The police is empowered with more power to curb the movement of people across the streets and all those stuff. At present, the government is vehemently defending this particular custodial deaths. And even a minister has quoted in a press meet that only if the person dies inside the lockup, it can be considered as a custodial death. And we cannot have a much absurder defense than this. And reports, the police have said that one died of fever, one died of, you know, other ailments and all those stuff. The opposition have, hit the streets, particularly immediately the CPIM hit the streets with protests. The state secretary was detained for conducting a protest in Kudalur. And the DMK leader has, you know, demanded immediate inquiry into the incident and the suspension and the legal course of action to be taken against the cops who are involved in the incident also. The traders union across the state, you know, downed their shutters in protest against this custodial death also. And the human rights organizations have also, demanded a detailed inquiry into the repeated incidents of police action against the suspects. And very recently, you know, we have seen a lot of issues of bathroom slippages in police stations. When the police pick up one or two suspects for inquiry, the next day a photograph will come up in the newspapers with, you know, statements of they slipped inside the bathrooms and fractured their hand or leg or anything. So this is going beyond control and the state has to interfere immediately. The Madras High Court has also taken, you know, required registered SOMOTA action, and they have a required report from the superintendent of police as well. And the DMK leader and Thoothukudi MP, Kanimuli, has remanded NHRC inquiry as well in the issue.
So what are some of the demands that are being raised by the movements? Also at a larger level, not specifically only with respect to this incident, which is about action against the culprits, but at a social level, what are some of the key issues and debates that are coming up right now?
The Tamil Nadu police have been known for their brutal attitude towards the suspects. A lot of, you know, even in 2018, the state stood second in custodial murders, next only to Gujarat also. So there has been a prolonged discussion about the way the suspects are handled in Tamil Nadu, which has demanded a lot of reforms in the roles as well. And the role of the judiciary in permitting custody to the suspects has also come into question. A couple of days back, former Justice of Madras High Court, Mr. Chandru, has also demanded the dismissal of the magistrate who, without physically verifying the victims, allowed remand. So such issues are coming up every day, every now and then they are coming up. The compensation is being also sought for the family of the victims along with the, you know, a government job for the family members. But in a larger perspective, the issue is more, you know, much worse than what we have understood. A lot of things are happening, but nothing much is coming out. The inspector who is, you know, accused in this particular case also is not is a sixth accused in an attempt to murder of his own son-in-law. That news came out just today. And the two sub-inspectors who are suspended with this in this incident has also have criminal records or the same things which they have repeated earlier as well. They have a track record of transfers, you know, actions, all those things are also existing. So the department as a whole needs a lot of change, where the government has to stop supporting these kind of actions. Mm-hmm. And in the 2018 incident, where a lot of deaths, custodial deaths were reported, no judicial inquiry was also, you know, permitted by the government of Tamil Nadu. So in a way, the government is trying to, you know, threaten the people by encouraging such actions of the police department. Right. So the social, the human rights is being severely violated in many cases. The social right activists have been demanding the action against the police. And the district superintendent has been, you know, some sort of hiding of facts and all those things are also happening. And, you know, yesterday another individual has also died, right, reportedly because of the police brutality in Tenkasi district, the neighboring district of Thoothukudi as well. So this is, you know, some sort of, you know, ongoing process which has to be stopped at the earliest.
Right. And as far as the government's response is concerned, we know that the government is already under a lot of criticism for its handling of the COVID-19 disease. And even before, it has been under criticism for a general lack of direction and inability to pursue an agenda. So how is this being seen from that perspective?
See, the government's failure is coming out every another day. The spread is very wide. And the case of Madurai, I want to reminder here, because the Madurai MP, Mr. Venkatesan, has been demanding the increase of tests in Madurai because a lot of people are coming back to their hometowns. That is some case in many other districts as well. The cases are also increasing in other districts also, apart from Chennai. So, a minister, Mr. R.B. Udayakumar, has threatened case against the minister, against the member of parliament for demanding the increase in tests. So, that is the attitude of this government in handling this pandemic. So the failures are continuing, the number of cases are increasing, the discrepancies are existing in many areas, including the number of tests. And Chennai Corporation today has not released the number of cases which has been reported in a particular zone as well. So a lot of hiccups are going on. There is a, you know, communication gap between the health ministry and the Chennai Corporation. The relief measures have not reached the people who are deserving. A lot of things are happening, and this is, you know, another, you know, jewel in the cap, which is, you know, which the government does not want. Any government does not want. So the government has a lot of things to handle, and with a very short time to, you know, for the elections to come, the government is in a soup, to say, to be honest.
Thank you so much, Hiraman, for talking to us.
In our next segment, we look at certain high-profile sports persons contracting COVID-19. This includes tennis star Novak Djokovic and members of the Pakistani cricket team. We talked to Leslie Xavier of the Sports Desk on these developments.
Leslie, thank you so much for joining us. So quite a few high-profile cases of COVID-19 in the sporting world the past week. And this, of course, is not completely unexpected or out of the blue. It's a sport involving a lot of contact. It's sport generally involves a lot of contact. Sport involves a lot of travel. So in some senses, it was expected maybe. But nonetheless, it's a worrying trend for both social and reasons and the sector itself. So could you talk a bit about these aspects?
Yeah, the weird bit is that this has nothing to do with the sports, inevitability that there would be contact and there would be chances of spreading, because these things happened primarily because of a lack of planning or following of protocol, and also a callous approach towards safety and towards the norms that have been set by WHO and established and fine-tuned by a lot of sporting leagues across the world, where this action has restarted. For instance, football, the leagues are restarted, and though cases have crept up, but very minimal. Testing has been there, and players have been kept in safe bubbles, and things have been okay. So it's not exactly because of the inevitability of contact that sport brings. And so the getting into the high profile test positives that happened last week. The first thing, the first news was from the tennis world. Djokovic, the biggest player who got infected was obviously Novak Djokovic, world number one. And so the five tennis players who have gotten affected by this are all part of this Adria Tour, which was a charity tour which was initiated more or less by Djokovic and to aid basically those tennis players who have been struggling, the lower ranked tennis players who have been struggling to make ends meet. So it was a revenue generating and a philanthropic endeavor, so to speak. But Djokovic, to start with, has had a the approach towards this pandemic has been little questionable, because he doesn't believe in vaccination himself. And so he has been very vocal that he would never get vaccinated even if a vaccine comes out. So perfect, it's fine. A person is entitled to his or her own personal beliefs. But when a sportsperson of Djokovic's stature says something like this, it is likely to sway a lot of opinion in his favor. There will be a lot of people who look up to him, and they would think that, yeah, maybe as a point, maybe vaccination would open you up to a lot of other issues physically. And maybe that's why when a fit and globally renowned person like Djokovic, who has a lot to lose if he doesn't vaccinate, because at some point when vaccine comes out, only the vaccinated players will be allowed to play in the tennis tour. So he was vehemently against vaccination. He said that he will never get vaccinated. And then he organized this tour. And apparently when the tour match was happening in Croatia, there was no protocols of social distancing and safety factors were put in place. It was quite a mess, so to speak. And a couple of days later, Grigor Dimitrov was the first person who came out, whose test came out positive, and following which three, four other players plus Djokovic. And the latest in the list is Goran Ivanisevic, who is right. Novak Djokovic's coach. Yeah. While at the same time, Alexander Zverev, the German who was part of the tour, he was seen and photographed partying in Monte Carlo on Sunday. He went back to Monte Carlo and he was supposed to keep himself in self-quarantine. He, in fact, had come out with a statement as well, saying that he is sorry that he was part of this tour, which has jeopardized tennis's restart endeavors, so to speak. And he said he will observe his quarantine. And I don't know what exactly the reasons that prompted him to go out and party, but that's irresponsible behavior too. So when tennis is trying to restart, the economic implications on that sport is huge, because of the kind of tournaments that have been scrapped so far. US Open is the major tournament that is trying to stage itself later this year. And many in the tennis fraternity believe that this Adria Tour fiasco would have a very negative impact on players willing to attend that tournament, or even stakeholders getting involved in that tournament, or even the government giving sanctions for the tournament to be staged. Because US Open, obviously, it's a much larger occasion, much larger tournament, more players would be involved, more support structure around organizing a tournament, more people would be involved in the venue. No matter how close you conduct it, you can't be without a certain level of amount of people being involved in that venue. So that's the larger implication on this, because by this behavior, the players, in the sense, it's perfectly fine to organize this charity. No one is questioning the legitimacy of their motive to organize this or anything of that sort. But they should have been more responsible and more diligent and more organized in when they went about this, because this would have, this has jeopardized tennis's cause very badly.
Absolutely. And I think in cricket also there's been a recent instance.
Yeah, so cricket's again, it's much closer to home both ways, because cricket is cricket is the favorite sport Indians follow, and this has happened across the border in Pakistan. So international cricket is starting this coming week with England playing West Indies in a test series, and the West Indies team is already there. No incidents whatsoever. The team was there a fortnight or so back in England, and they have been training. They isolated themselves for 14 days and they have been kept in a confined facility. They are training and they would be shifting to venues where hotel facilities are there, so the players are not expected to step out, and everything would be, I mean, they are following the protocol that probably they borrowed from English Premier League, because football has been happening in the UK. And the tour after this, it's Pakistan's tour of England, where they will play 3 test matches and 3 T20 internationals. And the team was selected. The selected players were called in by the Pakistan Cricket Board to the main centers, Lahore, to get tested before they travel for the tour. The team is already there in England. They traveled yesterday. But what happened was, when the tests were conducted, 10 players out of the original 20 that was there got positive results. And then a couple of days later, 6 out of the 10 turned out to be negative. So a confusion happened over there. And primarily the confusion is because, again, the Pakistan Cricket Board didn't follow a systematic way in convening these players. So they should have looked up again at other sporting entities who have restarted action. So when football was starting in by the end of May and early June across Europe, Germany to start with, and then Spain and England, they started convening their players in a very, slow and laborious process, where they were got in from their homes and then they were quarantined, and then the training started individually. And then they were training in 3 or 4 player batches. And then the combined training happened with the squad at a much later stage, when everything was sure that nobody else is infected and there's no chance that during training these things will pass on. Instead, the PCB just seems to have just called these players in randomly, the top players. And then they just, I don't know whether the directives were there for the players to observe what all should be observed before they come in. Because it seems that the players now testing positive means that they would have gotten infected in the last few days. And that means that they wouldn't have observed, they would have gotten out of their self-quarantine or whatever situation that they were in, probably, contained at home. And the moment they stepped out, they would have socialized. And it's apparent with the kind of spread that has happened. And secondly, positive and negative tests happening, false positives and false negatives, is pretty common in the test for coronavirus. So again, the PCB should have had a protocol of doing a double test before ascertaining whether a player is, before giving out the results and saying these players are positive, these players are negative. But they didn't follow that either. So that again puts a light on the scientific or the systematic lack of systematic manner in which the Pakistan board went about doing this. Again, it all boils down to responsibility to the sport, because cricket, international cricket happening is a very big deal. Pakistan Cricket Board has been struggling financially even much before this the coronavirus pandemic that way. And international tours happening is very important for them, because the kind of broadcast revenue that it could use for all those development activities that has been stalled by the pandemic. And it works for England as well. England are not doing any favors to Pakistan by hosting them. It's an important tour for England. And when such instances happen, again, it jeopardizes the entire process of how cricket can come out of this lockdown period and slowly establish itself within the parameters that safety parameters that is a must at conducting or organizing sport. And the whole world is looking at such things, and at the lowest level also these protocols and all will be established. Exactly. in the long run, so that things happen right from the grassroots at the state level, the national level, because otherwise if a faltering happens right at the top where all these facilities are available, then how exactly. I just don't understand how sport will come out of this at all.
Precisely.
The right way.
And there is of course also a social angle, in the sense that sportspersons being somebody a lot of people in society look up to, there is definitely the question of how such instances are perceived by the people at large. And obviously there are sportspersons are also individuals, they have their space and they have their freedom, but they also have a role that they play in society. So there's that angle as well.
Exactly. And for any country for that matter. So talking about Pakistan first, again, Pakistan cricketers are the preeminent sports persons of that country, because cricket is huge there. And so it is possibly the first sport that is coming out, to play, as a national side or even at the local level. So all the youngsters, all the fans, all the people who are there, it's a positive sign that sport is going to happen. So it's a sign that soon, it's very clear that this pandemic and this lockdown and the concerns of safety and all has taken a huge toll on people's morale and psyche. And so seeing the national team play would be something that would give them hope to start with. And then when that process was started, out of irresponsible behavior, out of not having a set protocol or whatever the reason is, when these infections happen, again the people are taken back to a much more darker space to start with. And secondly, they are also unsure as to how to keep themselves safe, if at all, if the players coming out and showing by example that this virus is there and we have to live with it, but we can live with it possibly by maintaining a very hygienic and well set protocol, then that is an example that everybody could follow. So that's not set either. And then there are instances like Alexander Zverev that I mentioned, where you just can't stop. What kind of a responsibility is that to the society or to the game or to yourself too, by stepping out and having a party when you were supposed to be quarantined? So it tells a lot. And it casts a shadow on the entire sport. But then the reality is that these are few sports persons who are erratic. Not everybody is, but then the damage is done, because the news spreads fast, and then people would start having a diminished view of sport and sports persons, and also the social responsibility that the sport has towards the larger world.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you so much, Leslie, for talking to us.
That's all we have in this episode of Let's Talk. We'll be back with the latest news developments of the day tomorrow. Until then, keep watching NewsClick. You